Hello and welcome to a new video on the CrypTool YouTube channel in the Basics of Cryptology series. In this video, I want to have a look at another construction method for block ciphers. You probably already have seen my video on the construction of substitution permutation networks. If not, I suggest that you have at first a look at this, because there you learn basic terms that we need in this video. But if you have seen this video, then you know that when you construct SPN ciphers, you always have to construct inverted S-boxes, inverted permutations, and so on. And this can be quite difficult. And because of that, there's the invention of Feistel ciphers or Feistel networks. And this is the topic of this video here. And I structured the video into different parts. First of all, I want to give you an introduction, what is a Feistel cipher? And then we want to have a look at the simplified DES or SDES cipher. And the SDES cipher is a simplified version of the DES cipher, which shows the principles of the DES cipher, but in a very simplified way. And of course, it's based on a Feistel network. But first, let's have a look at our topic graph. And as we already know, cryptography is the art of making ciphers and cryptanalysis is the art of breaking ciphers. And in this video, we want to have a look at cryptology, cryptography, modern cryptography, and of course, symmetric modern cryptography. And the Feistel network is for constructing a modern symmetric block cipher. First, let us have a look at the history of Feistel ciphers. A Feistel cipher is a block cipher which structure is based on a so-called Feistel network. And the Feistel network was invented by a cryptographer whose name is Horst Feistel. And in that time, when he invented the Feistel network in the 70s, he was working for IBM. And the first commercial use cipher that was based on a Feistel network was so-called Lucifer. And Lucifer is a direct predecessor of the data encryption standard, or DES cipher. And the Feistel cipher has the advantage that encryption and decryption are very similar, and often you can even use the same construction or the same hardware or software to encrypt and decrypt. You do not need to change anything despite the order of the keys, but that we will see on the next slides. And finally, many modern and of course some old block ciphers are based on these Feistel networks. Here on the right side, I put a picture that I found of Horst Feistel, who invented the Feistel network. So why do we use Feistel ciphers or Feistel networks? Feistel networks are well researched and they are known to be well suited for the construction of block ciphers. So there was many research based on Feistel networks, and this research showed us that these Feistel networks are quite good and quite secure. So a Feistel cipher has n rounds. And a single round consists of a so-called round function f, that's very important, the round function f, which results is often XORed with 1/2 of the current round's text. What this means, we will also see on the next slides. And then we have two researchers, Michael Luby and Charles Rakoff, who proved that when the round function is a cryptographically secure pseudorandom function with round key KI as seed, then 3 rounds are sufficient to make the block cipher a pseudorandom permutation, and already 4 rounds are sufficient to make it a strong pseudorandom permutation. So how do Feistel networks and Feistel ciphers work? Feistel networks divide the current round's text into 2 parts. We call this left and right. And each round works on a different round key, KI, where the I is between 0 and n, so we have n rounds. And the encryption works as follows. The next left part of the text is just the previous right part of the text. So that you see here, this part of the plain text just swaps over to the left side here. This here is the encryption visualized, I took it from Wikipedia, of a Feistel network. And the right next part is the left part in the current round XORed with the so-called F function. And the F function is based on the right side of the round and the key. So you see here, the right part here just goes here, and the left part from the last round is XORed with the F function's result, where we use the K1 and the right part in the current round. And this always swaps from left to right, from left to right. The left part always is XORed with the F function, and the right part just goes over to the next left part. So swap here, and so on and so on and so on. And in the end, you get the last right part, which becomes the left part, and the last left part, which becomes the right part. And the nice thing with the Feistel network is that the decryption also works the same. So the decryption, you just take the right part and the left part here, you swap these, and then you use in each round again the F function, but with the keys in the reversed order. And when you do this left, right, always F function on the left part here, in the end, you get the original plain text here. And here you already see why we don't need any inverse S boxes. The S boxes, the permutations and so on, everything is in this F function here. And since we only XOR the result of the F function on the left parts, we don't need in the decryption here the inverse of the S boxes, the permutation and so on. So this makes the construction of a cipher using a Feistel network really easy. We don't have to think of invertible S boxes, invertible permutations and so on. So let's have a look at an example Feistel cipher or a Feistel network that is used in the SDES or simplified DES cipher. And the simplified DES was designed by Edward F. Schaefer in 1996 for educational purposes. So the idea was to help students learn more about modern ciphers, of its construction, and to learn how DES works, because SDES is a simplified version of DES. So the idea is that students that use the SDES or implement the SDES, that it's easier for them later to understand and to implement the DES cipher. And that's because SDES has similar properties and structure as the real data encryption standard, but simplified. So let's have a look at the properties of both ciphers. On the left side here, I have SDES. On the right side, I have the DES. Both are, as I already said, Feistel ciphers. The SDES only works on 8-bit plaintext and ciphertext. In contrast to that, of course, DES works on 64-bit blocks of plaintext or ciphertext. Then the SDES only uses a 10-bit key, while DES uses, of course, a 56-bit key. The SDES only has 8-bit round keys, while the DES has 48-bit round keys. Then the SDES has only 2 S boxes, while the DES has 8. And of course, the SDES only has 2 rounds, while the DES has 16 rounds. And the nice thing with the SDES is that it is so easy that it can even be performed by hand. So you should try it, get the specification of SDES, try to implement it, or even try to do it by hand. It really works. And then you can use, for instance, CrypTool to check if your results are the right ones. So let's have a look at the building blocks of the simplified DES cipher. I divided the building blocks into parts. So we have the cipher itself, and of course we have the key schedule, which produces our round keys based on the key you put into the cipher. But let's first have a look at the cipher itself. So we have an initial permutation, that's just like a transposition, and we have the inverse initial permutation. This here is IP, this is IP to the power of minus 1, so the inverse. Then we have a map function, and the map function is just for changing left and right of our blocks. We will see on the later slides. Then we have the expansion permutation function, EP, and this is used to get more bits out of less bits. What I mean with that, you will see on the next slides. Then, of course, we need the XOR for applying the round keys. And finally, we have the S boxes S0 and S1, and these are the only non-linear parts of SDES. Then let's have a look at the key schedule. Here we have two different permutations, P10 and P8. These are like transpositions. And then we have the half circular left shifts, LS1, and what this does, we will also see on the next slides. So let's first have a look at the key schedule. And what I did, I took the visualization that we have in Crypto2, I cut it into different pieces that we can focus on each piece, for instance, here's a key schedule, and then I can describe it here on my slides. So first you put in a 10-bit key. And the first thing that happens then is the permutation P10. It just permutates the bits as shown here. Then we have a left shift 1. That means, and it is circular, that means that these 4 bits here are just shifted 1 to the left. You see these lines going to the left, and the bit that would be shifted out of this string or bit array here gets here. And the same applies to the second half, and this is why it's circular shift. So you have two circular shifts in this 10-bit string. After that, we have the P8 permutation. And the P8 permutation just reduces the 10 bits that we have here to 8 bits. And these 8 bits then go out as round key K1. But of course, since this is a two-round cipher, we need a second round key. So we use the string here, the 10 string before the P8 permutation, and this goes to the next part of the key schedule. Then we have two times the LS1 function, so two times circular left shifts. After that, we have again the P8 function, which just selects 8 bits out of our 10 bits and permutates these. And finally, the result of this is returned as our second round key, K2. So, quite easy key schedule to generate two different round keys. So, let's have a look at a single round of the SDES. And what you can first see here is that our round key goes in here. So, this is a connection to our key schedule. So what happens in a single SDES round? So we get our input text here, and the write part here just goes into our F function. And this is returned and XORed then on the left part. And the write part here also just goes through the cipher. So the left part is encrypted, the write part is not encrypted. And what happens in our F function? First, as I already said, we take the 4 bits here of the right side, and these bits then are permutated and expanded with an expansion permutation function. So we have here 4 bits, and then as a result we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bits. On these 8 bits we use the round key. It's just XORed each bit, XORed on each bit of the result of EP. Then we take the 4 left and 4 right parts of this result here, and we put it into our S-boxes. So we have the S-box S0 here, and we have the S-box S1 here. The 1 is behind this blue line. And here we can see the S-boxes in detail. So this is this part here. And how does this S-box work? So we just use these here, these 4 inputs, these are 4 bits, as coordinates to get out a value of an S-box. For instance, if we have here 0, 0, 0, 0, then we return 0, 1. If we have 0, 0, 0, 1, we return this, and so on. And same applies to the second S-box. So as a result, you get 2 bits from the first S-box and 2 bits from the second S-box. And the output of the S-boxes then is permutated to a 4-bit output string, or 4-bit output bit string. And this bit string then is XORed on the left part of our current block that we want to encrypt. And this is a single round, and the same round then is used 2 times, that we will see on the next slide. So here's the complete algorithm for encryption, and I simplified it by just putting these rounds here that we saw on the previous slide as black boxes. So SDS starts that you input the plain text. We have a first permutation, and this is also similar to the original DES. We have a first permutation at the beginning and then the inverse permutation at the end. And we were asked in our lectures, why did they implement this? And I think that the answer to implement this is to make it easy to implement in hardware, because you can easily implement permutations just by wiring these up, but to make it a little more difficult to implement this in software. Then, of course, we have our first round with our first round key K1. And then we have our map function. And the map function is just for implementing our Feistel network. So it takes the right side here, puts it on the left side. It takes the left side here, puts it on the right side. And since we have only 2 rounds, we only need 1 map function. Then we have the second round, where the round key K2 is applied in the same manner as in round 1. Then we get a result of this round. And as I already said, the final inverse permutation of the initial permutation is done, and then we get our ciphertext. And when you want to decrypt, we have to just reverse this and put here K2 and K1. And here you can see the complete algorithm as we have visualized it in CrypTool 2. And I want to just describe what you see here and how it works. So on the left here, we have the, I would call, encryption circuit. It looks more or less like a circuit of electronics, but it's just a visualization. And then in the middle here, you have the key scheduling, what we named here key generation, where you put in the key. And on the right side, you have the decryption part. And when you switch the SDES component to encryption, you will see values here. And you see all the values in these text boxes here as intermediate values. And you will also see the key generation values. But if you switch the SDES to decryption, you have to start here. So the decryption, the ciphertext will go in here, and then the flow is upwards. Here, that's because here we have K2, so we just flipped it around. And then here we have the first round with K2, also the switch, and the second round with K1. And this is the visualization that we have in Crypto2. So now we have two tasks. First of all, I want, of course, to show you how to encrypt and decrypt using our SDES component in Crypto2. And our second task is that I want to also have a look at the internal states of the SDES with our nice visualization that we have in Crypto2, as I already showed you. And a hint, if you like, for instance, SageMath, SDES is also implemented in SageMath as a cipher. And I put in here the link to SageMath SDES implementation or description of the implementation. And I will also put this link below this video. I'm here now in Crypto2 and I want to show you how you can encrypt and decrypt using our SDES component. And I want to show you the visualization of the SDES component. To have a look at the SDES component, I just search for a template with SDES. And we have here the SDES cipher template. Just double click it. And you get this template here. So what do we see here? On the left side of the template, we have a text input for plain text. You can enter the plain text as text and ASCII encoded. And since the SDES component needs as input a CrypTool stream, we have to convert from the text to CrypTool stream. To do so, we use a string decoder and it's set to text ASCII. Then we have our SDES component set to encrypt and electronic codebook mode. So with the component, you can use different block modes. I will have a look at this block mode later in this video. Then of course the SDES needs a key and the key is a 10-bit key. So it's encoded here in binary, but here it's a byte array. And the SDES component uses each byte as a 1 or a 0. So you have to convert here this to the byte array, and this is set here to UTF-8. So it gets a 1 not as binary 1, it gets a 1 as an ASCII 1. And then internally it converts this to a bit string. So this can cause some irritations or some problems, and just use this template so you're on the safe side. Then the SDES returns also a CrypTool stream, and since we want to visualize it, we convert it to hexadecimal, and we'll see here the hexadecimal numbers as ciphertext. So let's just test it. You click on play, and our text here, the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog, is encrypted to this here. But I want to show you an interesting property of SDES, and that is that in fact as the SDES cipher here executed in electronic codebook mode is nothing more than a simple monoalphabetic substitution. What does this mean? For instance, when we have here an A, the A is encrypted to a binary block of data, and when we get the hexadecimal representation of the A, we get 0, 1. And what happens when we encrypt another A? Then, since the block size is 8-bit and the ASCII encoded value needs 8 bits, it's encoded again to 0, 1. And when you enter another A, it happens again. And when you enter an arbitrary text, then of course, same happens. For instance, the LL here is 5757 and so on. And what does this mean? This just means that you can actually break an SDES encrypted text in electronic codebook mode using frequency analysis, as if you would break a simple monoalphabetic substitution cipher. So now let's have a look at the internal structure of the SDES. So I enter here A, and then I have a look at the presentation. And you have to restart when you have a look at the presentation, because the presentation is only updated when it's visible, so we have to restart it. And let's have a look at the internal working. As I already said, here we have the key schedule, so we get two round keys, K1 and K2. And we have our plaintext block here, which is first permutated using the initial permutation. Then the write part here goes into our first round here, or the F function of the first round. The two S boxes are applied, and then the result here is XORed on the left side here. And the right side just go through. Then we have the part that makes this here a cipher network, that's the swap of left to right. And again, the second round is applied here, also with the S boxes, with the second key. The right part just goes here to the end, the left part is XORed with the result of the F function here. And in the end, we have the final inverse permutation, and we got our ciphertext 0000 and so on 1 that we have here. Now let's have a look at decryption. You just stop it here, you copy the hexadecimal value 01 to the left side, and then you have to change this here to hexadecimal. And since we want to see if the decryption is right, we have to set it to text. And then we can just start it again. Oh, sorry, I forgot the most important thing. The SDS has to be set to decryption. And again, and we have 01 hexadecimal is decrypted to the letter A. And then now let's have a look at the presentation. And as I already said, you don't look from upper to the lower. You have to go here to the lower. Our decryption works as follows. We get in the 0001 value. It again gets permutated by the initial permutation. The right side here goes into the S boxes, into the F function here. The left side is XORed. This is done with the second key. Then we have the switch here, or the switch of the both sides. Then we have the other round with the first key here. Everything again, expansion here, S boxes, and the result then is XORed on the left side. We get this value here. And in the end, it's again permutated using the IP inverse function, and we get our original plaintext. Yeah. And this was everything that I wanted to show you with Feistel networks and with the simplified data encryption standard, or SDES cipher. I hope you liked the video. If yes, give a thumbs up. If not, you know what to do, give a thumbs down. And I also would suggest that you try it by yourself, so you can play with CrypTool to test it, and you should also implement it, because it really gives you a better understanding how block ciphers, and in this case, how Feistel networks or Feistel ciphers work. So see you in the next video.